We're looking at the connectivity, the exchange of organic materials between an intertidal bay. This is Young's Bay. It's a very broad tidal flat incised by a small river, the Young's River, that is connected to the Columbia River estuary. Just west of Estuary, maybe 30 kilometers from the Pacific Ocean itself. And so we're studying how much material important to the ecosystems of the bay, the ecosystem of the Columbia River, are exchanged between the bay and the river itself.
When he asked me to come help him, he was like, here, make this tripod and make it look like this. And I went out into the yard back there, and it's just like a pile of metal. And I was like, cool. It's like, you know, I felt like a kid, you know, building with my erector set. We built a couple rather good-sized tripod landers that were about half the size of this table, and filled them with all of these instruments that you're seeing laying on the table right now.
As you're planning a field trip, you really want to put this instrument in the spot, the sweet spot where, you know, the currents are strongest, where most of the flux transport is happening in this lateral bay. Well, those are often the shipping channels. Those are often the areas where the fishing industry is putting out gill nets. And in fact, Young's Bay is a region where lots of salmon gillnet fishing is happening. And so I think one of the challenges, but also one of the fun things about doing this is you don't just do it. You don't just say, I'm going to put my instrument out there, because other people are using the river.
But then once you're out there, the tides change so quickly that Jim and the captain had to time everything really carefully for weeks beforehand to make sure we knew exactly, you know, we were going to hit the tides at the right time and we weren't going to get stranded behind a bridge or something.
The timing of the tides is critical. I mentioned that this is on a tidal flat, so we're working on high tide. We're on this 64-foot boat with a 6-foot draft. It's going to get stuck if we don't get out of this embayment in time. We had a few drawbridges that we had to get by in order to deploy instruments on in the upriver towards the Young's River.
So we're scurrying around the deck and we're strapping things on and doing the final checks with the instruments. We check each instrument, write down serial numbers, make sure we know, because when we pull everything out and it's covered in mud, you know, at the end we're like, you don't want to be asking, you know, which instrument was in which position or what depth.
All through this, I'm thinking, okay, we just have to just keep going, keep our tasks getting accomplished, and we'll get it done. But I'm always thinking, are we going to get it done?
That's the nature of oceanography, and certainly the nature of estuaries. It's a really dynamic system, and you want to be prepared for anything. So.
But if you want to know what's going on over time, measuring things in detail over tidal cycles as they change, how things change when a storm comes through, how things change when river discharge changes from the Columbia River, or conditions on the coast change, then you really have to have instruments out there for long periods of time. Instruments like this that measure currents in the water have been around for 20-ish years. Instruments that are measuring the optical properties of water, these types of instruments have been around less, and really over the last few years they've become developed well enough that you can keep them out there long enough to make the measurements we need to quantify how much material is going from one spot to another. That, I think, is one of the more recent advances in oceanography that's really helped us.
This instrument is really cool because it has a fluorescence probe that gives you a proxy for both chlorophyll and cyanobacteria, phycoerythrin pigments. And so we can look at both the cyanobacteria and the phytoplankton, or it's a diatom-dominated system for most of the year. And then we also have a conductivity and temperature probe to tell you about the salinity and temperature in the estuary. And then it also has this cool biofouling wiper, which is important for us if you're going to leave something out in the water for a month or two. You want to make sure that you can get good data for as long as possible.
Nice thing about this study, we didn't necessarily intend to have things in for these 2 months. In fact, in October we tried to get them out, but things didn't work out. Sort of fortuitously, we didn't get it out until about a week ago, and so we were able to capture a few storms as well. So we clearly see that when the currents are flooding into a lateral bay, dissolved organic matter concentrations are low. When we see the water flooding out, we see that dissolved organic matter is high. So there is a flux from the lateral bays and organic material from the bay to the estuary. I think the conclusion we're making, though, is that it's not that big. It's not that big compared to this fire hose of material that's coming down from the river itself. And really, with regard to organic matter, it's the fire hose of the Columbia itself that is the dominant source.